Hello and welcome to the internet in the show called Morning After the Euros. Picture this. I worked this out. I've not seen this on the internet. But because I follow Spain so much, or I've been following Spain since 2008, I can come up with this stat or this mirroring of results, because in the quarterfinals, 2008 Euros, Spain won 4-2. Yesterday, Italy won 4-2 in penalties in the quarterfinals. In 2012, Spain won 4-0 in the finals. And in 2016, Italy won 2-0, maybe in the pre-quarters or the quarterfinals. Not so sure which stage. But yeah. So apart from the 4-0, 2-0, which did not mirror itself, the 4-2 penalties at quarterfinals mirrored itself. But in terms of result, now in the last 12 years, both teams have played each other in this European Championship. They've won two, lost two. So on this very, like, not history repeating itself, but like history mirroring itself. That's the term that I came up with yesterday. But
Yeah, like a cycle kind of a thing, right? Like,
on a
yeah,
day
but
when
Spain's victories after 2012, they haven't won against Italy in this championship, and it's been weird. Like, it's you can't even call it a cycle or per se, because Italy have had their own couple of small cycles in that time period, and Spain's cycle has been so long spanning, like it still hasn't ended by the looks of it. I don't know,
Yeah,
like
Busquets
it's
is there. Jordi Alba is there.
exactly. That's exactly my point. Yeah. So, I mean,
Anyways, the intro. On the day when, on the day when the two Italian defenders really showed all the experience, and Donnarumma showed why he's going to be the greatest goalkeeper of this generation, at least. It's already a big compliment. And Pedri did not misplace a pass until the 118th minute. And Alvaro Morata got to score, but then misplaced his penalty. Wow, this game had it all. I mean, had it all in terms of what? Like, it had all the right ingredients to enjoy 120 minutes of football and not like 90 minutes of football and one and the other 30 minutes of time wasting. It had it. Like, I was pretty satisfied with the game. For a semi-final, lived up to its expectations. First half, conservative, still trying to break each other down. The approach was there. Second half, the goals came. Then in the extra time, they were trying to do stuff. That's as far as I can go saying. But yeah, I think they had one eye on the penalties already. But
Especially second half of extra time. I think first half of extra time was completely Spain. And second half of extra time, I think both teams. Well, honestly, like I don't blame anyone for being like, oh God, let's just go to penalties, because it's been too much football. Like, it's been too much, right? Like, we've talked about this. Like, the guys look dead on their feet. Like, an 18-year-old was somehow like Spain, this was Spain's third extra time that they were playing. And that 18-year-old was on the pitch for like almost all of them. And yeah, we have to talk about him. We haven't done it yet. We have to talk in detail about this guy.
Well, he's
And
gonna be a star. He has 1 year
he's
on his
already a
contract.
star. Like, why do we talk about what's the future here? Like,
Yeah,
he's
he's.
already doing it. He's already bossing semi-finals of the European Championships. Like, I haven't seen this from an 18-year-old man. I've not seen this. Like, yeah, like Ferdinand thinks that somehow Phil Foden is the most talented player Guardiola has coached. I'll keep bringing it up. It pisses me off. And
The English bias.
it's, oh, idiot bias, honestly. It was a stupid thing to say. And like, this 18-year-old, he's playing at the highest level. He's keeping out superstars out of the team.
Thiago doesn't get a
He's,
place in this team. Wow,
yeah,
because
Thiago's not playing. I mean, he's being kept out by an 18-year-old, and this 18-year-old is every bit as good as any other midfielder in the world. I mean,
Did he hear what Enrique said? Even Iniesta hasn't did not have in it him did not have it in himself at 18 the way Pedri has done it last night. So
Iniesta was too small for that time, at the time period that he was playing, right? Like, he could be, but I'm not saying he was played off the pitch or something like that, but like, he couldn't consistently like be in the team because of how the times were at the time. Like they were, you needed to be a bit burlier. You needed to, especially in English football, you needed that.
Mm-hmm.
Like the diminutive player, the guy, the slight player, like that. That's been a recent. Like I don't remember a lot of players in the past who weren't physically at least held their own, right? Like Iniesta is not the most physical person around, nor was Xavi.
But Pedri is still, I mean, he still reminds me of a small physically limited.
Yeah, he is in that mold. Yeah. He is in that mold. Yes, definitely. There's no doubt about it.
I mean, this entire Spanish side looked like that. Like nobody had the muscle, like literally. Did you see anybody? Yeah. One person.
Well, you don't need to have the muscle. Like you have the fight. Like I think Danny almost a good example of a player who won't back down. Like that's what I felt. Like I don't care if he missed the penalty, honestly, because another thing that I saw from this is a lot of people coming to conclusions from this. I mean, there was this comment that I saw was like Juventus players are superior because both players who scored in this game are Juventus players. I'm like, it made no sense. Absolutely no sense. Because
because
that person is a Juventus supporter. I'm just talking about the fickle-mindedness of fans and how people are. I mean, the funniest thing about it was the two guys that Morata scored against, like the two central defenders in the middle.
The Juventus defenders.
What team do they play for? Juventus, you dumbass. I mean, what's wrong with you? And I mean, there were so many things that you see every day around you in the terms of like one game cannot make any... Like my problem with Morata or my problem with Ciro Immobile, it did not turn up with one game. I've watched these guys a lot and I've not enjoyed a lot of the things they do, or I don't understand what's so good about them. That is why I don't like them. And this game did not change my opinion on it. Like Ciro Immobile was poor this game.
Oh, he
did
was.
Did you know he's supposed did to be play? A kind of player who runs in behind? Did he like, play? Did you know that?
Did he play? That's my question. I did not fucking see him. Until
he was part of the gold, wasn't he? He didn't get the ball and that supposedly was his pace. Like, the Irish commentary is terrible. They will try to praise Ciro Immobile for no reason. Like, he didn't get the ball and he got praised for it. I mean, I was shocked.
He assisted the goal, but yeah, wow. As soon as he assisted, like, the next minute he was out of the game.
Yeah, he got taken off. I mean, and needed him to be taken off because I think Berardi came in and was more interesting as an option, at least as an outlet.
But what I was really keeping an eye for your observation that you concluded about Italians trying to score from outside the box. Hopefully they get to a couple in the finals. But because like they were really trying to like go from outside the box,
it wasn't that prevalent because I think Spain held so much of the ball.
The first goal, of course, like the curler was still not completely out of the box, but like it had the elements of like being like the thought process of like, yeah, I need to curl this from outside the box. Doesn't matter if it goes in or not. But yeah, the attempt was there. Then there were a couple of other attempts as well. Not literally from outside the box, but a couple of yards inside the box and then trying to curl it. But yeah.
Yeah, I think it's about space there, right? Because Chiesa had space there because the moment he cut in, he got some space for himself and he took the shot. It had to be taken. And the most interesting part of it was that the guy was unfazed. Like, that's a very interesting thing that I didn't personally observe it.
Yeah.
There's a thing with... I was listening to a podcast about Steph Curry, okay? They were talking about... It's Bill Simmons who was talking about it. So he was talking about the fact that Steph Curry's father was an NBA player, right? So and he played for a long time. So Steph, as a child, had an idea of how NBA locker rooms worked and what exactly is an athlete professional, is an elite athlete and stuff like that, right? And then you have an idea of how, like, you're not playing, so you don't know exactly how it works, but you have an idea of how the inner workings of this thing, how it works. And it gives you understanding of the moment that a player who's completely outside from it does not understand. And that brings me to my point. Federico Chiesa's father was a professional. And that is why I think Chiesa was the most unfazed man on the pitch. Like, Ciro Immobile barely did anything, right? And Insigne was not his... he was so good in the against Belgium, and he was not as good as... So, they needed somebody like that. And Chiesa was the man who stood up. And he's done that for Juventus also. Mm-hmm. Like, he didn't care about... He doesn't care about Ronaldo in the team or whatever. Because his... Like, that, the fact that his father played professionally, he's got an understanding, and he's got a self-confidence that is hard to find, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, kind of like Steph, like, he's not Steph, like, nobody's Steph, but yeah. there is that factor that if you know how these things work and you've been inculcated in this environment, then you have a sense of security, and you have a sense of understanding of your position in the game. Yeah. And most players just don't over their whole career.
I mean, of course, that element, like, having, because most of the time, like, these young kids who are growing up with fathers playing professionally, they already have this environment, like, what's happening in the dressing room, at least the end of the season feeling, or like once in a while they get to, like, the other players, like, in the dressing room, how they're going about their things, how they're going about their routines. So how they mentally prepare themselves more than the physical part, because the physical part, the warm-ups, we see it, like, before kickoff.
Yeah, it's about the mental and emotional part. You're
the
right.
Mental part behind, like, in the dressing room, like, only the, I don't want to say privilege, but only the
children. Well, it is a privilege in a sense, right? Like, it's not a privilege also in a sense, like, especially in elite sport, like, if you're not that good, the comparisons and the media pressure will kill you. Especially for somebody English, like, thank God, like, a Marcus Rashford or a Jadon Sancho doesn't have a parent in the sport, because they would have had to face a different kind of scrutiny. But honestly, I think the kind of life they've led to be here, I think they would take that, wouldn't they? Like, 14 years old, don't really have food to eat and stuff like that. I mean, it's unimaginable for us, isn't it? Like, and that is why being disrespectful to those guys, I don't get at all. I don't get it. Like,
Well, time to praise this Italian side, because they were never, ever in my shortlist to, like, win this tournament. I thought Belgium would stop them. I thought Spain would stop them. Jesus Christ, no one is stopping them. And now I hope nobody stops them. Or at least the other. So,
like, that's the best way to avoid an English win in this. Like, I like the England team, let's be honest. But yeah, like, I couldn't handle the fan thing. Like, I don't want to imagine, honestly. Because I might have to face that reality. And I think me and you are in the same boat in that sense. Okay, that's not the point at all. This Italian team...
32 match unbeaten streak. Something that we are really critical about. But I also brought this up last week, that when you're in transition, you don't want to play the big sides. You want to play
the thing worked, right? The thing worked, exactly. It worked a charm. Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
Since Mancini's come in, I mean, until the Swiss game, again, I'm repeating the stat, they hadn't conceded for like 1128 minutes. That's a world record for national teams not conceding a goal. Like, Chiellini, oh my god, Jorginho Chiellini and Bonucci and Donnarumma, wow, what the hell is this? Donnarumma, Octobers, I've seen taller goalkeepers, like this Fraser Foster, he's quite tall, he actually, like, could sleep on the line and then cover his entire thing. But oh, this guy's so agile, and I mean,
he's much better than he was at 17, and he was so hyped at 17. Like, at 17, he was just a big burly dude, right? He's got that footwork is there. Now he's got a confidence about him as well.
He's, like, got an aura about
him. Aureola client actually helps in that sense, right? Like, the self-confidence and the boost that you get from your supporting cast is so good.
I
don't know if he's going to be the best keeper of the generation, but he's well set up to be that. About that.
He goes to PSG now. I mean, the agent thing, I still don't get it. Like, agents having bad influence on players' career, but, like, when you're, like, really so good, You can trust the agent no matter
he's
how.
Not a bad influence per se. I think he's just too, like, he's a bad negotiator with clubs.
Yeah.
But for the players, he's always been a positive. He's always been a positive. I mean, except for the Paul Pogba situation, he hasn't handled too well. Like Zlatan. Like, Zlatan is has done, like, the confidence that Zlatan exudes. Like, Mino Raiola is a part of it.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
And the same way with Donnarumma and a lot of these guys. Like, they like Erling Haaland, look at that guy. Like, he's the man is so for the players. Like, he's so dedicated to improving his players' lives that the players will undoubtedly love him. Like, there is no way they won't.
Yeah. But wow, he still has to displace, firstly, 4-time Champions League winner Kylian Navas. We'll see how.
I mean the disrespect that Navas has gotten, like, from the clubs, like, forget the fans,
from everybody.
Like, he's so disrespected. Like, I mean, you don't, that's not your problem. Like, your problem wasn't the fact that you didn't have a good enough keeper. Like, yeah, you had an opportunity to get Donnarumma, you got him, that's fine.
Yeah.
But, like, sell him and send him somewhere where he actually try and win another Champions League, because you're not going to do it. PSG is not going to win a fucking Champions League. I hope, at least.
Mm.
I mean, forget, like, I misspoke. Qatar is not going to win a Champions League. And
oil money is not going to win the Champions League. Because
that was proven, right? Even Pep can't do it.
Yeah, I was just going to say that. The blue part of Manchester can't do it. Like, why the hell can Paris do it? Yeah, but these three, and then they just have the right pieces in a jigsaw. Like, you completely say, like, everything just fits. And Mancini,
I think it's not even a fit thing. The squad, the spirit, like, there is such a, like, they changed the way. Like, it's a 10-12 year odyssey for this Italian team. Like, Sacchi started it in the 2000s and he took over the developmental, like, Italian FA developmental thing.
Yeah.
And he was talking about it. He was like, we have to be more like Spain. And they have replicated the formula the same way England have, right? Like, the two teams that the two countries that were excellent at developing their players and developing their talent are kind of on the slope, downward slope now, in Spain and Germany, right? And these two teams, like Italy and England, have picked up that mantle and they've realized exactly how to give the talent a chance and give that talent an opportunity.
Yeah.
And they've done really well with it. And Mancini and Southgate both have a perfect understanding of what the system is trying to do and how we are supposed to use the talent that we have at our disposal.
Yeah. I mean, it's the perfect blend of experience and youth for Italy, because they are one of, in terms of experience, they're still one of the oldest teams. Like, yesterday they fielded a 28.8-year-old. That's quite old. And Spain were like 26 years old. That's like, I thought, like, Spain would get them in the extra time, because the average games the players.
Yeah, well, Bonucci and Chiellini have been there all the time. Those are the two main old guys, right? Like, who else is really old in that team?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, they showed us against Belgium also. Like, the dude, those guys, their understanding of how the game works, the way they position themselves, I mean, it's incredible. Like, there is no other way to describe it. Like, their age doesn't matter after a point. Like, it's a number. Because it's just a number.
I mean, age for goalkeepers and for defense, it shouldn't be a big deal. And especially when you're playing like this low block defense, when you just need to make that wall and just clear the ball with your head every time it's swung in the box. Unless you're going like head to head with an Mbappe or like Haaland for a sprint on a counter attack.
Yeah. But
this is not the game the Italians play anyways. They'll never let you hit themselves on a counter attack. So,
and even in international football and in like these kinds of tournaments, it's hard to beat a low block in that. Like, it's hard to counter attack and stuff. As like, their team is not playing a high line, so where is the space to get in behind? Like, there isn't. Like, Morata did really well though with that. Like, he was able to get through, and the runs that he was making were very interesting and very hard to track for the Italian defense. But they were able to recover, and that's exactly the point. Like, you might be able to get away for a minute, a second, or for a couple of seconds, but they won't give you enough space to score all the time. Like, yeah, obviously they'll concede because that happens in football. But yeah, most of the time they'll be able to cover their backs.
Yeah. Well, and then the midfield, like since Verratti's come on after his injury, like it's really added more muscle and more solidity to this. But Jorginho, my God, what's in his veins? Jesus. The art of taking a penalty. Like this is like the run up, the step up, it's all Neymar written over it. But he scored.
Yeah.
Jorginho, he puts it at the back of the net. I think he's just
missed once. Like it's the same way Bruno Fernandes functions. Like he'll just score. Like they're just so like I don't know if who's better in Jorginho and Bruno Fernandes, but like the way Jorginho took the penalty, right? Like the way he played with the keeper's mind. Like I've witnessed that so much. Like that is why people get so pissed about Bruno Fernandes and stuff like that, because he's that fucking good at it. Like it's so irritating to watch somebody get so many chances from the penalty spot and actually put them away almost each and every time. Like I can understand people's frustrations.
Like I mean, for Liverpool, like I always think like, I mean Salah is good at penalties. He's not missed.
Yeah.
Any penalties, but his run up. His goal is run as fast as you can, hit the ball as fast as you can, and hit it anywhere.
Yeah, like before the same way Ronaldo does it. Yeah.
Yeah, before the goalkeeper reacts, yeah, it will be at the back of the net. Then with Milner, I mean, I think it's just the nervousness. You know, Milner is going to put it at the back of the net. And of course, I'm supporting that club. That's why you're still nervous that he'll miss it. He never does it. But with Jorginho, there's no pressure to like back Chelsea or like back in Italy. So that's why this, for me to enjoy this entire process, like this art of him like going for the run up and because Chelsea played like Liverpool in this winners of Champions League, Europa League, Super Cup, and Jorginho had this penalty and I was like, okay, the game went 2-2 and then to penalties. He scored this beauty, like he just made Adrian like step somewhere else and then he just put it on the left side of Adrian, not that far away as well. And then but yesterday's penalty, I was like, wow.
That was brilliant. Like this he just completely played the
man. Oh my, this is pure orgasm. I was like, you cannot do that. You cannot do that. Like firstly the disrespect, I don't know. Of course he doesn't mean the disrespect, but like Chelsea also put out a video of like how he takes penalties, like take a deep breath in, look at the goalkeeper, and I'm like, why? So is he trying to intimidate the goalkeeper and then like breathe out and then take a run up, step up? I don't get it. Like that, there's so much risk, the element of risk when you just want to like place the ball, you know, because you can make such a big fool of yourself. You're like, you're displacing the ball or you're just passing the ball in the net. And what we know of penalties to be is you run, you just hit it as hard as you can, or like you try to hit it in the corner, top corner, right, left, doesn't matter. Just make it past the goalkeeper as fast as you can. But this guy, like the ball is rolling. It's displacing itself at like 1 kilometer an hour. And the goalkeeper is on the other side of the net.
Yeah. So, it's about manipulating the goalkeeper, isn't it? It's a poker game. Jorginho always wins the game. Like that's how it is. Like it's a,
but I think respect to Zimon because
he was the first penalty was a good save.
Yeah. All his efforts were like on the right. So he made up his mind. I don't care where they are going to score. I'm just going to dive to my right. So maybe he could have had Jorginho there or maybe Jorginho would have thought a little bit more. But luckily for him, it did not work out. Unluckily for Zimon, it did not work out. But because in the end, it's just a lottery. You know, Zimon could either go left, right, left, right, left, or he could just go right, right.
In Jorginho's case, I don't think it's a lottery. I think there's a lot of mind games involved in this.
The penalties.
Yeah. No, but exactly. There's a lot of mind games involved, and you have to be like the fact that he's looking at the goalkeeper. That's definitely part of the manipulation. Like that's part of catching, like the goalkeeper's trying to catch your bluff, right? Like basically, that's what it is, and like showing him because generally like when you're keeping at a lower level, like you're suggested to look into the player's eyes because like they'll try and give away what side they're going to shoot at generally, But like at that level, I'm pretty sure it's not that simple. It's a much more complicated thought process.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a lot more patternic also. Like they, most keepers are given a piece of paper, right? That gives them an information of which side these guys prefer to shoot at and which side they've taken their last penalties at. So they, there's a lot of guesswork from that perspective also. And
I mean, what's your point with this? Like, I really want to, I'm not so sure. Like, let's discuss like brief couple of minutes with penalties. I mean, there's so much data in the game now, but in terms of penalties, you as a goalkeeper and I'm your goalkeeping coach, do you want me to give you the stats like, okay, Jorginho is scoring here, Berardi is scoring here?
Yeah, like they won't they won't give you an exact thing. Like in the, they'll give you a sense, in the they'll give you an idea of what side they would give you a final guess. Okay, they won't give you the whole details of what's the last penalty. I don't know. I think different keepers do different kind of research in that sense. I think they look into what side they expect the player to shoot it. Like that's what's written on that piece of paper that you get.
Yeah, yeah.
Because like, this was there for the Europa League final. De Gea was given a piece of paper. Because De Gea is not great at penalties. Like, let's to be very honest. Like, he's not the most accomplished penalty keeper. And
My question is, me as your goalkeeping coach, do you want me to give this piece of information to you, or do you just want to be like, okay, it's a fucking lottery, I'm going to go with my gut feeling?
I would prefer the data, personally speaking.
Yeah.
I would want as much data as possible, because like that gives me...
Spoke like a true data analyst, and that shouldn't...
Well, what else would you expect me to say? It's guesswork, right? Like at the end of the day, you have to put the probabilities against each other. That's just how I look at it. Like you need as much data as possible for that. Like to be able to have an idea of what side I should be diving at. But then when you're actually on that, like at end of the day, the gut feeling will always matter, because it's a face-off. The guy is looking at you. You're looking at him. You're trying to figure out what's going on in his brain.
Yeah, this
and you're trying to figure out. Yeah.
This is the thing. Like, no matter how much technology, AI, VR, data will come in our lives, I don't know. Maybe we are another like 100 years away from like the human factor, the emotion element to be implemented in technology. Because... like you said, like we can.
Yeah, that's almost impossible, isn't it?
Yeah, you can give as much data.
At least now it is. Like, I don't know what's
going to happen in the future. In that moment, to have this eye contact with the other human being and to like try guesswork, what's he thinking and what's on his mind?
Yeah.
Where is he going to put the ball? Yeah. But yeah, what are we now?
Because data and information came later. Like, humans are social animals. Like,
yeah.
We are like, that's the first thing we know how to do, which is try and converse with each other and gossip, basically. That's what the first humans did.
Yeah.
So, and another thing that is there is that at the end of the day, like XG is a metric, right? Like, but the game end of the day is played on the pitch and the scoreline is there in the stands.
Yeah.
Like, that's just how the game is. That's just how that's how it's supposed to be. And that's what makes it fun. Like if we could predict what's going to happen, like then it kills the fun out of it, doesn't it? Like it's
then we just play on the PS, right? Because
let's just play Football Manager instead. Why do we play an actual game of football? Like why kick a ball then?
We are all Forza Ferrari. Jesus, we are all Forza Italia now, no?
Yeah.
Unless Denmark win, then yeah.
So, your Tifosi brain took over for a second, didn't it?
I still feel like the Italians are still deluded in terms of their passion. They're still deluded, but
yeah.
I mean, like I said, it's my driven agenda. Anybody but the English. So I don't mind the deluded passion.
Well, yeah, their delusion died a bit, didn't it? After 2018, the World Cup, that they didn't qualify for, like, the... There was a lot of heartbreak in this Italian team for a while. And, the circumstances in which it went down, like the De Rossi substitution and stuff like that. I mean, it was quite bad. And I think...
Mancini,
they are passionate,
so much credit,
but delusion, like, I think the English take the cake always in terms of delusion. Like, Like, Danish guys are sitting there wondering, like, Denmark isn't even the biggest footballing nation in the
nation.
In,
yeah.
Like, it's not even top 10 in Europe. Like,
yeah, yeah. It
in
is,
terms
I mean,
of. Yeah,
in terms
like
of the ranking,
10,
but yeah, you cannot explain the ranking. So, in terms of talent,
it's a,
no.
It's a ranking, dude. Belgium
yeah, yeah.
were number one. They
yeah,
you, they
yeah.
weren't first favorites
yeah.
for the tournament.
But let's
so,
let's like preview this, because have you already read the Kasmus Michael, like, seen the press conference?
Yeah, yeah, I saw that, obviously. And,
loved it, loved it.
Oh, yeah. For that's personal enjoy. I live in Ireland, dude. Like, that's going to be shared to me somehow, right?
Yeah.
Like, the hatred of the British, the guys who do it the best, I think they live where I live currently. So
I mean, the audacity, the delusion for the journalist to, like, retrace the question back and said that, well, we have won the World Cup. But I'm like, dude, this is the European Championships.
It's not the fucking World Cup. Yeah, you're not playing Saudi Arabia here. Calm your tits.
That was exactly the point that Kasper Michael was making. Like, has it come home? Because Denmark won it in 92 and England haven't.
Exactly,
won it.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the point I was going to come to. And
I mean, you ask the question in a sense related to the European Championship, then you get a answer back wherein you are on the back foot, and then you completely want to change the direction of the question, which is like, I'm like, come on. How long have you been in this job again? Oh, Jesus. Wow. But yeah.
Yeah, I don't blame the journalist on honestly too much, because they're supposed to ask these kinds of questions, right? Like, especially in a press conference in London, which is against the opposition that England is going to play. You'd want to get into their heads, right? And you'll use any means necessary.
Yeah.
He had a platform. He used it. And Kasper Schmeichel didn't really look rattled at all. Kasper
of course,
Schmeichel,
like,
just...
this is also like this. I really want to add a little bit of, like, this language element. Like, apart from the Great Britain, all these islands who speak English, like the Dutch and the Danish, they can fucking nail English. So
yeah.
Kasper Schmeichel knew exactly what he was saying, and there was no way for anybody to get lost in translation. So yeah, I'm glad, like, he looked back at him in the eye and, like, gave him a answer. If I mean, not him, but the journalist kind of looked rattled. And if this is going to be played in the English dressing room, I'm pretty sure they are also going to be like, okay, we didn't expect that.
Yeah, I don't think it is. I think that there's a important line that has to be drawn. The British entitlement and that journalism issue and the fan issue and the four terrible words. It's coming home. Like that is on one side, and this team and their coach is on the opposite side. This is a good team, solid set of young players. It's a team that's growing. And they have a manager who knows exactly what he's doing, which is something that has not been seen for a long, long time in the English job. And there is a sense of delusion that is there on the side that I was talking about, the journalist side, that is not there with this team. This team is a lot more purpose-driven. They have a very much better understanding of where they stand in world football compared to anybody in England. I mean, you can't even blame the English fans, honestly, for trying to celebrate it. But yeah, like, they go overboard with the sense that, like, enjoy your team's wins. Why wouldn't anybody want you to enjoy it? It's not against the English. You create that vacuum in yourself. Like, people who are complaining about the fact that people hate the English. Yeah, you're the ones who did Brexit. Did you forget that? It's just 5 years ago. You wanted to fucking leave the European Union, even though you were, like, half in it. And because you were like, these people are just trying to steal our money or something. Like, I don't know what reason you did it for, like, as an individual. And I don't personally care, because you've been hoodwinked by a government whose hair is as terrible as their policies. And I mean, why wouldn't you understand the fact that people hate the English? Everybody hates them. Why? Because you want to pretend you're superior. That the fact that you've got inbred royals at the top is supposed to be a cool thing, and I'm supposed to care about it. I mean, I don't care about this old lady with a handbag, but you do. And that's the problem. You care about things people shouldn't care about.
Old lady with a handbag. That's a good one. I'm going to keep that in mind and use it for my future.
Oh, yeah.
To
keep anything, like I say. Because there is that sense of entitlement and superiority. And who better to tell the English that they have an entitlement problem than two Indian people sitting around. I mean, yeah, we can see the exact, like, we can pinpoint instances where we directly had to face this problem with the English and
a word for the Danish team. My God,
let's talk about that. I don't want to get too much into the garbage there.
Loving this team, man. Like,
yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
it was. I told you, like, from day one, Germany or Spain, like Germany to like support them. Of course, I'm supporting them. Spain also have a little bit of leniency bias, like them as well, simply from football that they brought like 12 years back. And but in terms
of, you have a personal Spanish thing anyway, so
in terms of like winning over you, like as a football romantic, and it has nothing to do with Christian Eriksen, it has nothing to do with him. This team just has that charm, like, you know.
There's a recklessness to them, and that's what you love about football, isn't it?
Combine strength with charm and with emotion. Like,
Højbjerg
on his knees crying after the quarterfinals. Do you expect a Viking guy to, like? Of course, I love like anti-masculinity or like or like great.
Yeah, like that machoism is. I think that thing is slowly, it has to die out of football, and it's very, very important because. Especially look at how homosexuality is treated in this in men's football. Women's football is a completely different story. Women are generally better at dealing with these things anyways, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And there is such a, like, the last person who actually came out and was open about it, dude, that guy had, he couldn't stick with a single club.
He was slaughtered, no? Yeah. Entire career.
Yeah, like he died and he had a drug abuse problem and a lot of things. Like, I read the story. I forgot his name. I'm so sorry. But I mean, there's a huge problem with that. Like, they talk about LGBTQ and the rainbow band and stuff like that. Like, we don't know how many footballers who wanted to be open about their sexuality but had to stay closeted because the environment wouldn't let them. And we have to, as a fan also, we have a huge part to play in this. We have to be more open and we have to be more receptive to anybody who wants to live the life they want to live. And it's just as simple as that, isn't it? And you were talking about there was a Viking thing you were suggesting, right? Like,
I was saying, like,
I mean, they are badasses, right? Like, Højbjerg is a typical badass looking.
They can
dude,
be
right?
Badasses, but they can be. Yeah. But so far during this tournament, they've just played like the
bride. They played excellent football. That's what they've done.
Like, slowly. I mean, people are noticing them. Of course, like, when there are just four teams left, people will, of course, notice you. Otherwise, I don't know, what are you, like, are you blind or something? But like, as soon as I had this feeling during the Russian game, I'm like, it's just written in the stars because they just had to win. They just had to win. The scenario was also like, no matter that you lost two games, you can still make it out of the group because of the stupid format which you are against. I love that format, even though it doesn't
I hate the format and I will hate the format. It was such a freak thing that happened, dude. Like, the Eriksen thing, like that game, the fact that it had a result that, I mean, it's weird, right? Like, that's always going to...
Let's not give 30 seconds more to this format, but like, I just want to make my point. Like, it's a stupid format. I agree. The reason I love it is Switzerland and Denmark made it. Switzerland beat France by finishing third. Stupid, no? In an ideal world, they shouldn't even be like in the pre-quarters or the quarters because they finished third. Denmark, because of everything that happened to them, they finished third and then they still made it out of the group. So this narrative around it just gives a different narrative to the spectacle.
I think Denmark, you're right about that. But
anyways, UEFA are like known to like reward failure. Anybody who finishes third in the Champions League group goes to Europa.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It's not about failure, honestly. It's more about maximizing revenue. You want the best teams to be there in a tournament for as long as possible.
Yeah,
that's what it is. Like, it's very simple. Like, UEFA is not a complicated organization. The way they think is the best way to make money, which I think in their opinion, even the best way to make money, they're wrong about it. Mm-hmm. They go about it incorrectly, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Because like, we can have this conversation, but I don't know if it's the right time or place for it.
Yeah.
But okay, let's talk about the like the game that we are going to see. And until unless you actually want me to talk a bit about the UEFA money thing.
We can cover that on the podcast next week. The longer
one.
Let's conclude this one. Already gone over time.
Yeah, we've already gone.
You already have your pick, I guess. And yeah.
Yeah, I think I'll take the England pick because I think you'd want to take the Denmark one, honestly. So I don't mind giving it to you because I personally like this English team. Like, I'm a fan of Gareth Southgate. I'm a huge fan of he's a smart guy, first of all, and his selections aren't based on what the media says. Like, that's not been the case for in English football for a very long time.
Yeah.
Like, the fact that he chose to draw Phil Foden when Phil Foden was the most hyped man on the planet. Like, people forgot Lionel Messi existed also for a second for some reason. For some unexplainable reason to me.
He's still the greatest. And
he is the greatest. Like, there's no debate there. And, I mean, I don't know. Like, the Jadon Sancho coming into the last game, that was an excellent choice. The fact that the moment they brought in Maguire, Harry Maguire was fit as fuck. He wasn't lacking at all. He was his Manchester United self.
Yeah.
Like, that's a Viking right there. Like,
yeah.
He's impressive. Harry Maguire is an impressive dude. Like, yeah, the Greece thing happened. Like, yeah, but still, like, at least from what we've seen on the pitch, like, that's all we know, right? Like, I don't know him personally. Okay. So,
and the entire, very impressive. Like, Manchester defense covering for England, like, he switches from a 3 back to a 4. And like,
yeah, exactly. Those tactical decisions have also worked really well. Like, the what they did against Germany and then Ukraine, though, they were a pushover. Like, Ukraine, I think they just ran out of gas. So, yeah, they were bound to lose out after a point because, like, you need to learn there are steps to it, right? Like, okay, the first time they've actually got into a quarterfinals. You wouldn't be like, oh, these guys know exactly what to do in a quarterfinal. No, they haven't been there before. This England team still has. This semifinal will be crucial in that sense because both teams have not been to a final in a long time with this set of players or even this set of like a manager or coach or whatever. So that will be new territory for both these teams.
Yeah.
And in a lot of cases, when you have an understanding of the situation, I think that's what the most important thing about Gareth Southgate is. His understanding of the situation is impressive.
Mm-hmm.
Most people don't have that.
Yeah.
Most people don't understand exactly what they have at their disposal, but he supposedly does. At least he's shown us indication of that he does. The English might not really like him because I'm pretty sure Gareth Southgate out will be the chant if they lose to Denmark, which will be absolutely moronic. Another reason why we would hate the British fans and the media perspective around it. Like Raheem Sterling, if he misses a penalty, I can't imagine what's going to happen to him. They'll try and crucify him. They'll try and...
But if Phil Foden misses out...
The crime of being black and in the English national team is heinous. I mean, it's disgusting what Raheem Sterling has done by being black. I mean...
Just look out for the reactions when Foden misses and when Sterling misses.
Yeah, Foden will be like, oh, Gaza missed one too. Oh,
it's this meme, right?
Yeah, like,
oh, come here, my dear. Come here, my dear. Gordon Ramsay, dear.
Yeah, the Ramsay one. Yeah,
you fucking donkey.
Yeah, that is what it is.
Yeah.
And I mean, the thing that you have to figure out is how to deal with the Danish fullbacks. I think that's the thing I wanted to come to. That's my actual point.
Yeah. Larsen.
That's the big thing. Yeah.
Oh. Also, like, since you mentioned Southgate, I want to, like, just briefly mention Kasper's Julmand. Wow. This guy is some coach here, man. Like, just quietly getting about his business, like, giving his ideas and philosophy to the team. And it's so nice to see in an era when, like, players are dominating football clubs in terms of, like, coach choices, like, these two bodies, the players and the coach, they just get along so well, like, synchronize and, like, fit into each other's, like, just wanted to point that out. But
there are 3 semi-finalists which have that kind of atmosphere and aura, right? Like, even the Italians, like, they look like they love Mancini, and Mancini loves them like their own sons, like his own sons. I mean, it's always like these kinds of teams are always great in that sense. I think France had that in the World Cup as well. The love for each other and the love for their coach.
Yeah,
obviously it dies out after a point, and the ego
but there was this,
inflated. It's a team of superstars. It's hard to manage.
Yeah, I just came across this article from Athletic. I don't even give a lot of attention to them, but they were already like spilling beans about the disruption in the French squad for this championship. So yeah, maybe it's just a clickbait. But anyways, yeah, go for the fullbacks. Let's
yeah, that's going to be the hard one to deal with, because what we haven't seen till now is England actually concede and go behind, right? That's not so, they haven't conceded at all in the tournament, and actually seeing them go behind, like, that's what's going to tell us what this England side is completely made of, because that's one challenge they haven't faced. And this Denmark team is very well placed to put that challenge to them. I think Denmark understand the fact that there is a good chance that the English team completely breaks down when they go behind. And Harry Kane scored, but he's not the most in form or the most impressive looking player in this tournament. That credit has to go to Leonardo Spinazzola. And I mean, you never know, because the fullbacks will be hard to handle, because they push up, they will. And Larsson is excellent at set pieces also. So,
yeah.
I didn't know anything about Stuart Larsson. Did you know anything about him before this tournament?
This is the beauty about these tournaments, no? Like,
yeah,
they just like spring out.
Yeah, I hope he doesn't get a 40 million move or something. Like, just build another club season. Like, just I don't know which club he plays for also. Like, Malda, at least I knew. I had watched Atlanta a couple of times. And like, I don't know if I've talked about this with you, but the rotation thing that they do, like them and Leipzig, the couple of things that the movement things that they were doing, like, you get enchanted. Like, you're like watching this and you're like, this is not something I've seen before. Like, this understanding of fluidity and this understanding with each other. Basically, yeah, it's very very fascinating to some of these fullbacks in both the fullbacks in this team.
Mm-hmm.
And Damsgaard will be another player to watch. And Kasper Dolberg, like from obscurity at Nice, he's turned up and he's playing well.
Yeah.
And I'm very interested in watching this. Like, the center backs, we still know, right? They're most of them are Premier League players. So, Christensen, we knew. Vestergaard, we knew. And it's a ball-playing team. That's the most interesting part about it. Like, everybody in that team can play the ball with their feet all around.
I'm glad you said that. But, like, watch out for the counters, yeah? Because they've had so many counter attacking options. So, I don't know how Southgate is going to line them up. Like, just cancel out each other so he plays three at the back? Or, like, is he not going to have the ball? Because even though, like, this Danish team, like, they are covered in all aspects in terms of tactics.
Yeah,
They can keep the ball. They can keep the ball beautifully and they can... like kill you on the
dimensionality
counter.
In this Danish team is what's the most impressive part about it. You brought it up. Yeah, that's going to be England's biggest challenge, because they can play through the gears. This Danish team can. We don't know if this English team can.
Yeah. Especially like if Denmark are one down, they'll be like, well, we've seen worse. We're coming again. If the English are down, we've not seen them in this situation.
Yeah, there was a crude joke that I could make here, but I didn't want to. Like, it's too soon. It's too soon.
Yeah, okay. Tomorrow. On that note, wow. We've breezed past this, and like, let's hope tomorrow we are celebrating a Danish win. Final thoughts before I stop this and we say goodbye until tomorrow.
Yeah. Final thoughts, basically, interesting contest.
Yeah.
On paper, England do look better. Let's be honest. Raheem Sterling is in excellent form. And that will be the danger man for England. If you're able to handle Sterling, you've done quite a bit of a job. And because Sterling has the confidence with England to go anywhere on the pitch he pleases. And it works. Like, the thing is that he gets into spaces where he wants to be, and he affects the games really well.
Yeah.
He becomes he's always a threat.
Yeah.
And let's see how the Danish deal with it and how the English are able to deal with this multi-pronged attack that the Danish have got.
Last night's game was like quite even in terms of personnel and like the form. Of course, Spain played like two extra times, but you could just see like it was a great game for a semi-final and both were level. But today's game, what I'm seeing is like, yeah, more talent.
It's
on
an
paper.
X-factor team. I think England are facing an X-factor team. It can go any way. Like, and that unpredictability is not something I think Gareth Southgate would like. I don't think he would. You don't want to play an unpredictable team in international football, do you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, he's made the most of it because with Germany, of course, people with the media saying no chance, he used it to his benefit. And yeah, now he has to play this X factor.
Yeah, Germany was very one-dimensional, right? We talked about it in the group stages only with Germany. Yeah. Like they had that problem. Portugal, for some reason, didn't figure out what Germany was trying to do. But the other two teams in that group did. They knew exactly what Germany were going to try and do. The switch of play thing with Gosens and Kimmich. And that's what killed them because Germany didn't have enough weapons and enough versatility.
Yeah.
Ukraine weren't dimensional enough to even land a punch on England. Yeah. And the problem here is that this Denmark team is unlike both those teams.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, this is a hard one to predict, honestly. Oh, like, this is
I'm really looking forward
to it. Anybody thinking that England are going to sail through it, I think they've got another thing coming. Like, we can always be wrong. And I wouldn't mind being wrong. Like,
at least we are not making predictions like,
Yeah, we are not. That's not the objective of this.
Like driving a narrative. We are not driving a narrative here, apart from the fact that Lionel Messi is the greatest player.
Yeah, that's not a narrative.
Yeah, okay.
We can't call it fact because at the end of the day, it's an opinion. But when people are doing actual studies on how his footwork is and unlike any other player, like he's able to do 4 touches in the time period that a normal person takes 1 touch and stuff like that. Mm. Like the football's greatest, the Amazon Prime show, right? There's an episode on Messi.
Yeah.
And like there's actual mathematicians and stuff like that who are observing his play and who are observing how fast his footwork is and how he's able to generate a lot of pace with not a lot of backlift and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And Mason Greenwood can do the same. Like I've seen him do it. So that's not completely unique. But yeah, there's a lot of things about Messi that are completely unique to him.
Yeah. Well, let's hope he finally wins the Copa America. On that note, we are going to like say goodbye for now.
Yeah, we have to because it's gone
on
too
the
long.
Morning after the Euros. if you've made it so far, thanks for bearing with us. And we are going to see you tomorrow.